Hello and welcome to the news on NT International. We are streaming live on Vision TV 247 and other social media platforms displayed on your screen. I am Elizabeth Omori and our sign language interpreter is Shegun Ajayi. Now let's take a look at the headlines. President Tinubu suspends Minister of Humanitarian Affairs and Poverty Alleviation from office with immediate effect. World Health Organization holds supply of medicals to northern Gaza. And counting of votes concludes in Bangladesh elections. Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina wins her historic fifth term in office. Governor Hope Izoduma of Imo State has expressed belief that the 2024 Appropriation Act of the federal government will fast-track sectoral developments that will change the face of the country for good. The governor expressed his hope while talking to State House correspondents after his meeting with President Bola Tinubu at the State House. Governor Izoduma believes the solutions to most of the yearnings of Nigerians have been captured in the National Appropriation Act, now waiting for implementation.
If we look at the provisions in that act and the number of infrastructure and capital projects proposed by the president, if we're able to perform even 50% budget performance on that document, it will not be the same Nigeria. We have had instances where reforms were carried out in some countries. Some policies that looked initially as unfriendly policies, 2-3 months of gestation period, becomes the darling of all stakeholders. So I'm confident that the initial period of the takeoff of some of these policies that will give us a more robust economy will soon be over, and Nigeria will begin to enjoy the product of the new vision.
The governor also pointed out that the security situation in Imo State has improved greatly and that his government is working to consolidate relative peace following his victory in the November 11, 2023 election. Governor Hope Izoduma is due to be sworn in for the commencement of his second term on January 15, 2024. Now, in line with his avowed commitment to uphold the highest standards of integrity, transparency and accountability in the management of the Commonwealth of Nigerians, President Bola Tinubu suspends the Minister of Humanitarian Affairs and Poverty Alleviation, Dr. Beta Edo, from office with immediate effect. A statement by the special advisor to the president, media and publicity, Ajuri Ngelale, says the president notes further directs the executive chairman of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC, to conduct a thorough investigation into all aspects of the financial transactions involving the Federal Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs and Poverty Alleviation, as well as one or more agencies thereunder. The suspended minister is hereby directed to hand over to the permanent secretary of the Federal Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs and Poverty Alleviation. And she's further directed by the president to fully cooperate with the investigating authorities as they conduct their investigation. Furthermore, the president has tasked a panel headed by the coordinating minister of the economy and minister of finance to, among other functions, conduct a comprehensive diagnostic on the financial architecture and framework of the social investment programs to conclusively reform relevant institutions and programs in a determined bid to eliminate all institutional frailties for the exclusive benefit of disadvantaged households and win back lost public confidence in the initiative. These directives of the president take immediate effects. A bit from the judiciary, the High Court of the Federal Capital Territory has declared the prolonged detention of the former governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, Godwin Emefiele, as illegal. The presiding judge, Justice Olukayode Adeniyi, gave the verdict while ruling on the fundamental rights matter instituted at the instance of Godwin Emefiele. Chukwunon Sunwabuize reports that the court equally awarded a sum of 100 million naira as damages in favor of the applicant against the respondents.
Justice Olukayode Adeniyi, while citing the Pretoria of judgments by course of competent jurisdictions against the unconventional culture of arrest and detention of suspects before investigation by law enforcement agencies, condemned the actions of the agent of the first respondent and that of the chairman of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC, and the commission to have incarcerated the former governor of the CBN between the 13th of June 2023 and the 8th of November 2023, when he was released on bail on the order of the court without arraignment. The court held that the prolonged detention constituted a flagrant violation of Africa's fundamental rights to personal liberty, preserved by the provisions of Section 35 of the 1999 Constitution, as well as Article 6 of the African Charter on Human and People's Acts, Ratification and Enforcement Act. Justice Adeniyi further barred the first respondent and his agents from further arrest and detention of Emefiele without an order of a court of competent jurisdiction.
Judiciary has once again shown to be the last hope of common man. And I mean, the court has been able to give him that reprieve.
Efforts to speak with the counsel to the respondents were unsuccessful. Chukwunonsonwa Boeze, NTN News.
Meanwhile, the Supreme Court has affirmed the election of Haitsen Alia of the APC as the duly elected governor of Benue State. The five-man panel of justices, headed by Justice John Okoro, gave the verdict in Abuja. The apex court dismissed the appeal of Titus Oba, the candidate of the People's Democratic Party, PDP, in the March 18, 2023 governorship election in Benue State. The dismissal followed an oral withdrawal of the appeal by the People's Democratic Party, PDP, and its governorship candidate upon being confronted by the apex court that the matter was a pre-election matter. Oba of the PDP had challenged the victory of Alia of the All Progressives Congress, APC, before the tribunal, and the Court of Appeal in their verdicts, the Benue State Election Petition Tribunal and the Court of Appeal Abuja affirmed Alia's election as Benue governor, following his declaration by the Independent National Electoral Commission, INEC, as the winner of the March 18 governorship election. This verdict has put paid to the all adjudications on the conduct of the 2023 governorship election in Benue State. Away from the judiciary, Minister of Foreign Affairs Yusuf Tugar has assured intending pilgrims of improved services in this year's Hajj arrangements. The Foreign Affairs Minister stated this as Nigeria and Saudi Arabia ratified the agreement for the 2024 Hajj operations in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. Gadbrat Nata'ala reports.
The signing took place on the sidelines of the third series of Hajj and Umrah conference and exhibition in Jeddah. Minister of Foreign Affairs Yusuf Tugar and Saudi's Minister of Hajj and Umrah Taufik bin Fawzan Al Rabia signed agreements for this year's Hajj and Umrah, also known as Lesser Hajj. Culminating from this bilateral meeting includes new guidelines of operations for 2024 pre-Hajj, Hajj, and Umrah activities. Other issues for further attention includes the airlifting of pilgrims, having an endorsed airline, accommodation, and feeding of pilgrims.
We're going to see, inshallah, remarkable improvements with regards to flights, with regards to timing, and punctuality, like I said. And we have a brand new chairman of the National Hajj Commission.
Tugar further noted with satisfaction the arrangements put in place by the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in improving the 2023 Hajj operations, particularly in ensuring the safety and comfort of Nigerian pilgrims. Saudi Arabia's Minister of Hajj and Umrah Taufik bin Fawzan Al Rabia says his country will prioritize all issues raised by the Minister of Foreign Affairs and promised to work closely with Nigerian authorities to ensure seamless Hajj and Umrah operations. In attendance were the Chairman of National Hajj Commission, Jalal Ahmed Arabi, Nigeria's Acting Ambassador Mahmoud Lele, and the Consul General Bello Ibrahim Kasouri. The Nigerian delegation formally extended an invitation to Saudi's Minister of Hajj and Umrah to visit Nigeria. In Abuja, Garba Muhammad Atala, NTA News.
Now to sectoral review for the year 2023, access to clean water and improved sanitation facilities is a challenge for many Nigerians. Statistics shows that 60 million people in Nigeria do have access to basic clean water supply. In this special report, Usman Zubiru takes a look at the Ministry of Water Resources and Sanitation efforts in the year under review to improve water and sanitation sector.
The Federal Ministry of Water Resources and Sanitation mandate is to provide sustainable access to safer and sufficient water to meet the cultural and socio-economic needs of all Nigerians while enhancing public health, food security and poverty reduction. The ministry's first 100 days was spectacular. The nationwide formalization tour to the 12 River Basin Development Authorities to ascertain their functionality and how they can contribute to food security of the nation in line with the renewed hope agenda of President Tinubu's administration.
River basins are the veritable tools for securing food security in this country. We have a lot of arable lands, and by extension, if we grow more food, we will reduce the overbearing of our currency.
Flag of dry season farming and inauguration of integrated model farm is another effort towards increased crop yields, economic growth for Nigeria to be food sufficient, and fighting unemployment among teeming youths.
So I'm going to give you 100,000 naira for this machine. Go and buy the fertilizer. Yes.
Thank you very much.
In 2023, the ministry observed some major international days relating to the sector. These include World Rivers Day and Global Hand Washing Day. To improve the skills of stakeholders in the sector for optimal productivity, the ministry organized capacity building for water steering committees. Similar workshops were held on adopting modern irrigation technology to boost food production under the teaming project. These are all geared towards ensuring that Nigeria have access to clean water, proper sanitation and sustainable irrigation practice in the year 2024.
For dams, irrigation, water quality, water supply in the coming years will be to complete all ongoing projects and enhance that the priority areas of the mandate of our ministry are achieved in line with the Renew Hope agenda of Mr. President in the water and sanitation sector.
Ending open defecation by the year 2025 and Clean Nigeria campaign is another area the ministry has focused on in the year under review and has continued to solicit cooperation of media and the entire Nigerians to fight the menace.
Sanitation and hygiene important in the realization of this government priority areas, which we are talking about food production, inclusivity, economic growth, job creation, youth empowerment. How are we going to achieve this? All hands must be on deck.
For now, only Jigawa State is open defecation free according to available statistics. In Abuja, Usman Zubiru, NT News.
In other news, the National Inland Waterways Authority, NIWA, has confirmed that 8 passengers died in the unfortunate bus mishap that occurred at Umumu Annam in Anambra West local government area of Anambra State. In a statement signed by the Director General Manager, Corporate Affairs, NIWA, the incident that occurred on Friday involved a passenger boat traveling from Ida in Kogi State to Onitsha in Anambra State. The statement notes that preliminary reports indicates that the wooden engine boat rammed into a snag on the water channel and capsized with about 50 passengers. NIWA explained that upon receipt of the said report, relevant personnel from the Marine Department were deployed to rescue, recover and proper investigation. The authority commiserates with families and friends of the deceased while assuring the public that it is doing everything possible to ensure safer inland waterways for the movement of people and goods across the country. Now, the Nigerian Army 9 Amphibious Battalion is expanding its scope for crime fighting in line with directives from the Defense Headquarters. The battalion commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Oluwale Okedigba, stated this at the 2023 West African Social Activities WASA in Koko Wari North local government area.
It's the 2023 West African Social Activities WASA, organized by the Nigerian Army 90 Amphibious Battalion, Kokowarri North Local Government Area of Delta State to celebrate the diverse cultures of Nigeria. Devoid of much regimentation, the social activities brought together officers, soldiers and their families in a relaxed atmosphere to celebrate the end of a successful year and honor dedication to service. To the commanding officer, 90 Amphibious Battalion, the event is an avenue to commend personnel for their efforts in reducing crime in the area, in line with directives from the headquarters, and promise to further partner with the host communities for better security surveillance.
In the year 2024, we expect that we'll sustain the conduct of operations, enhance the operations to meet contemporary security challenges. I am saying this to the criminals. It is better they repent now, otherwise we are the day of reckoning.
In a message, 63 Brigade Commander Brigadier General Sanusi Aliu commended the battalion for working in adherence with the Chief of Army Staff philosophy of transforming the Nigerian Army into a well-trained and motivated force.
They should also come up with a very, very good warrior ethos. The warrior ethos that will make them not to ever retreat or surrender. Warrior ethos that will make them not to leave their comrade behind.
Awards and trophies were presented to deserving personnel in different fields. Ismail Musa, NTA News.
You're watching the News on NTA International. Time to take some messages. The news continues shortly. Thanks for staying with us. The National Universities Commission, NUC, has refuted news circulating on social media, some national dailies and television stations, to the effect that the commission has just discovered 100 fake professors in Nigerian universities. NUC says the media reports are fake and figment of the imagination of authors, adding that this is happening at an unsuitable time when the nation is awaiting the outcome of investigation into the fake certificate saga from universities in some neighboring countries. The commission therefore finds this development as unfair to all stakeholders, ill-conceived and a ploy by unscrupulous persons to create panic and provoke outcries at both national and international levels. The commission confirms that it initiated in 2019 a laudable project with the intent of complying and publishing a list of full professors in the Nigerian university system through the use of an online portal to collate the requisite data. During the exercise, the NUC found anomalies such as associate professors being listed as full professors. Based on the verified data, the commission then, in a landmark accomplishment, first published the list of full professors who participated in the exercise in 2019. It was understood that this would be succeeded by a continuous process of updating the list of full professors. It is important to state at this point that all the issues on the 2029 verification of full professors in Nigerian universities were concluded in 2019. Since then, the commission has entrenched a more reliable system of generating a list of full professors in the NUS. The commission is also conscious of the fact that some of the academics not captured in the 2019 exercise may now have matured and progressed to become full professors. This is the reason why it continuously updates the list of full professors in Nigerian universities. The commission therefore advises government officials at all levels, members of the university's community, international community and the public to please disregard these items of fake and stale news which have long been laid to rest in 2019. And now to the foreign scene, the counting of votes for the Bangladesh elections has been concluded, and Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina has won a historic fifth term in office after Awami League Party secured absolute majority in the polls. Francis Udojo reports.
After voting on Sunday, the counting of votes saw the Awami League take an early lead, winning 216 seats out of 224 seats on Sunday. The outcome of the rest of the seats is still unannounced, the election commission of the country said. However, being elected for her fifth term as the prime minister, Sheikh Hasina has become the world's longest-serving female head of state. The Awami League chief, Hasina, has instructed her party leaders, workers, and supporters not to hold any victory procession following the announcement of the results of the 12th general election. opposition party Bangladesh Nationalist Party BNP, led by former Prime Minister Khalida Zia, was flagged for anti-national activities ahead of the poll and announced a boycott of the vote after Hasina refused to step down from her post to make way for a neutral caretaker government. Election Commissioner Kazi Habibul Awal said after the polls closed. Meanwhile, Indonesian presidential frontrunner Prabowo Subianto suffered a barrage of attacks in a heated election debate, with his two opponents taking aim at his military procurement strategy as defense minister, calling him reckless and wasteful. Third-time candidate Prabowo, a former special forces commander, has held a strong lead in opinion polls for the February 14 election, but his military modernization drive drew flak in a second televised face-off focused on security and geopolitics. Southeast Asia's biggest economy has for the past decade lagged regional peers in defense spending as a share of gross domestic product. Prabowo justified the strategy to buy used hardware as essential in modernizing the armed forces, adding the 15-year-old jets had a 25 to 30-year lifespan. President Joko Widodo on Monday was quoted by media reports as saying that the data is confidential because it is related to the nation's big strategy, adding that people were disappointed by the personal attacks launched in the debate. Francis Udojo, NTA News.
Still on the foreign scene, the World Health Organization says it had been compelled to halt a mission to bring medical supplies to northern Gaza on Sunday due to the failure to receive security guarantees. The WHO stated that a planned mission to Al-Auda Hospital and other hospitals in northern Gaza has been cancelled. Comfort Fashion reports.
It was the fourth time WHO had to call off a planned mission to bring urgently needed medical supplies to Al-Auda Hospital and a central drug store in northern Gaza since December 26. The organization emphasized the heavy bombardments, movement restrictions, and interrupted communications as a deterrent factors, which makes it nearly impossible to deliver medical supplies regularly and safely across Gaza, particularly in the north. The delivery planned on Sunday, WHO said, has been designed to sustain the operations of five hospitals in the northern parts of the enclave. The World Health Organization Director General Tedros Ghebreyesus says he was shocked by the scale of health needs and devastation in northern Gaza. Ghebreyesus demanded for an urgent, safe and unhindered access to the north of the Gaza Strip. Meanwhile, Israeli government spokesperson Elion Levy said he did not have information on WHO's assertion, referring questions to the Israel Defense Forces. Comfort Fashion, NTA News.
No farmer, no future written on a sign attached to one of the tractors at a farmer's protest in front of the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, Germany. Farmers gathered for demonstrations, launching a week of protest against a government plan to scrap tax breaks on diesel used in agriculture. Comfort Fashion brings more from the global scene.
U.S. Secretary of State Anthony Blinken met with officials in the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia on Monday, then heads to Israel as he pushes for more humanitarian aid to Gaza, the protection of civilians, and to ensure the conflict does not spread to other parts of the region. Blinken's stop in Abu Dhabi includes a meeting with UAE President Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan. While in Saudi Arabia, he has talks scheduled with Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. The top U.S. diplomat spoke of the need for Israel to curb civilian casualties during the Israeli-Hamas war in Gaza and significantly increase the amount of humanitarian aid reaching famished Palestinians in Gaza. The United States has urged lasting peace and security for both Israelis and Palestinians. Meanwhile, farmers blocked highways access road in parts of Germany Monday and gathered for demonstrations launching a week of protests against a government plan to scrap tax breaks on diesel used in agriculture. Chancellor Olaf Scholz's unpopular three-day coalition infuriated farmers last month by drawing up plans to abolish a car tax exemption for farming vehicles and a diesel tax breaks. The proposals were part of a package to fill a 17 billion euro hole in the 2024 budget. The government on Thursday climbed down partially, saying that the car tax exemption will be retained and the cuts in the diesel tax breaks will be staggered over 3 years. But the German Farmers Association said it was still insisting on the plans being reversed fully and will go ahead with a week of action starting Monday. A bit on Africa, Somalia's president has signed a law nullifying a contentious agreement between Ethiopia and Somaliland in a largely symbolic gesture of his government's displeasure over the deal to grant port access. President Hassan Sheikh Mohamud said the law voided the illegal pact given landlocked Ethiopia long sought access to the Red Sea through Somaliland, a separatist northwestern region over which Somalia exercised little real authority. The passage of the bill is an illustration of our commitment to safeguard our unity, sovereignty, and territorial integrity as per international law, the president wrote on social media platform X, formerly Twitter. Unlike anything anyone else is doing, Murphy, who plays brilliant scientist J. Robert Oppenheimer, hailed his visionary director, while Downey Jr., portraying the protagonist's bitter rival, praised the movie as a masterpiece. Comfort Fashion, NTA News.
Thank you so much, Comfort, for the updates. Next is a look at the weather prospect for tomorrow, Tuesday. And that's the news. Thank you for your time. I'm Elizabeth Omori, and our sign language interpreter is Segun Ajayi.